Hi and welcome back to SallyHughesBeauty.com. I'm in the bathroom today with one of the most requested bathroom guests ever, I think. I think you are up there with one of the most requested. So I'm very happy we're here. We are in the bathroom of Ruth Crilly, aka Model Recommends. And we are in rural Essex / Hertfordshire in a family home. And we're in one of the bathrooms. I think we're going to go into the other bathroom a bit later because there's a bit more stash there. But we're
I liked it. We're in one of the bathrooms and then you could have left it really mysterious, like there are six or seven bathrooms.
Like we're just in a mere wing of your home.
Yeah, I'd have liked that.
Yeah, yeah. There are two bathrooms as far as I know. I think we're going to make it into both of them, but we're going to start here. So this is where, this is like the family bathroom, right? This is where baby baths and everybody drops in and out.
Well, this is husband's bathroom.
Oh, okay.
Because he likes a bath, I like a shower.
Okay.
So
that's
when
usually the other way around.
Well, I think you've got to be careful with baths. I don't want to go straight into something really gross, but as a woman, you know, I think sometimes too many baths and too many bath oils can mess with your
your delicate.
We're not even a minute in, are we?
with your delicate lady chemistry. I do love a bath, but normally men prefer a shower, don't they?
Well, not him, because he can go to sleep for about 3 hours in a bath. So, and this has always been a thing.
That's a train passing.
And that's a baby.
And that's a baby. There's also a dog here and a cat here. I think it's going to be an active one.
So you can see that this is why it's quite masculine in here.
Right.
And the other one's a lot lighter.
But this hooray for separate loos.
Oh my God.
Are you a door locker?
I'm not a door locker, no.
Oh, are you a door closer?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'll close a door. Not for a wee, necessarily.
No, not
for a wee.
Depends
on the circumstances.
Not for a wee. But would you, for example, shave your legs with the door open?
Oh, yeah, I wouldn't have a problem shaving legs. Yeah, I've never got that.
So it's just
what's wrong with shaving legs?
So
it's just toilet stuff.
Okay.
There are things that don't need to be seen. Also, breast milk expressing. That's kind of unattractive because the nipple goes all the way down the pipe.
It does.
It's just like
in and it becomes pyramid-like.
It becomes like a pyramid.
Yeah.
And already, you know, they don't, you kind of, the ownership of the breast area has passed on to the baby for a while. And, you know, they don't need to see that, I don't think.
I don't think I had that much dignity actually at that stage in the game. But yes, I know what you mean. So we're here with Delicate Flower, International Woman of Mystique. we're off to quite the subtle start. So tell me, so even though this is your husband's bathroom, you do seem to have loads of stuff in here, which I'm going to go onto in a minute, but you basically seem to have fragrances behind me and kind of general toiletries here. So we'll have a good look in a sec. But tell me, has all of this stuff, all of these products come to you since working, or were you always obsessed with product?
Always obsessed, and I found some pictures from when I was a teenager the other day, and in my 14-year-old bedroom, my wallpaper was magazine beauty adverts pasted with no gaps, like a collage over every wall, and then I had my encyclopedias and all my school books on the floor underneath the desk, and every shelf was just filled with beauty stuff. And I don't know. No, actually, I must have been 16 because I had a job. As soon as I turned 16, I got a job in McDonald's and I wanted to save up for my driving lessons. Mm-hmm. But I used to spend it all on beauty
stuff. And
where
did you grow up?
In Redditch.
Okay.
Mm. So, I used to just spend it all in Boots, especially if there was an offer on. And then by the time I got to about 18 or 19 and I started at uni, I was doing Dior, Clinique, Clarins.
So saving up for posh stuff.
Well, because they used to do the bonus times.
Yeah.
And I'm a real sucker for the miniature beauty items.
I like a mini. I like that bit in Superdrug where all the minis are. It's like pick and mix.
Yeah. But and I used to love in Body Shop, and they would give you a free sample, wouldn't they, in that little bottle. And I used to go in, and I used to put my hair up, and I used to go out, and then I used to take my hair down, and then I used to put a hood up, or maybe my scarf on, and they must have been like, this is the same girl.
What, so you'd keep going in pretending to be someone else?
Well, because you'd only get your Saturday shopping with your mum, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
And then they'd say, look, I'm going into Owen Owens, you've got half an hour, meet me back here in exactly half an hour. And of course, no one had mobile phones, so you had to be half an hour.
So you'd be like, how much free crap can I score in the next half an hour?
And I was quite ballsy, because I'd go up to, you know, posh counter and go, I'm thinking of buying a new face cream for the night. And I just would like to, you know, I always like to try before I buy. You know, it's like this tall.
Yeah.
Samples. Just love
obviously
it.
You had the gift of the gab.
Yeah. I don't know where it came from, really. I don't think my mum was really that into stuff. She's just sweet almond oil.
Right. One of those annoying people that looks lovely and goes, I just use soap and water.
Yeah.
Jeans are a good thing. So at which point do you go from being a punter loving this stuff to entering the fashion world? How did that happen?
Well, I was at law school, but I used to spend every lunchtime just getting quite drunk with my friends. And would either get
drunk. Was the intention to become a lawyer?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I was in my, I was at the end of my second year when I left to be a model. But before that, we were just going around Birmingham, and Topshop had a competition to find the next biggest model. It was with Models One. And all you had to do was put a photo of yourself into this box and write your details on the back. So I did, forgot all about it. And it was months. And I think it had got caught in, well, I like to think, it had got caught in the bottom of the box. And they said,
they just phoned 200 people before you.
They phoned up and went, darling, we've just found your thing. And I don't know how, you know, we didn't see it before. And we'd love you to come to London. Mm-hmm. And
so this
you
was know, Models come
and
see One. Us.
This was Models One. And I thought, oh my God, I'm going to be Kate Moss, millionaire. Went into law school, went, bye, see ya, I'm off, kind of thing. Then told my parents, which went around really well. And then just kind of never looked back, really.
So you moved to London?
I commuted for a long time. I used to get in my little Metro GTI and set off at 5:30 in the morning.
Wow. So Models One signed you then, immediately?
Yeah.
So you start working. Can you remember your first job?
First job was with my husband.
No way.
We didn't get together then. Yeah, but he was doing a test shoot, and he was doing this kind of Sid Vicious punk style test shoot, and he needed a girl that could look really kind of rock and roll. It was very dark. Like, I was, I'll try and find a picture for you. He saw my card in the agency, and I hadn't done any work by then, and the card was awful. And they were like, this girl would be perfect. He was like, no way, she's not right. And then they said, she's going to be in a minute, so you can meet her. And then he said, you know, I walked in and he was like, oh my God, she's perfect. And so I did my first test, I think, about 2 days after
that. And did you like him?
Yeah. But I shouldn't say this. Sorry, to his ex-girlfriend.
Yeah, but you're married with a baby now, so I think you basically get squatter's rights.
So this is like 15, this must be about 15 years ago now. Yeah. And we've been together for 13 years. So, you know, there was like a little time in between. But we did loads of jobs together then. And I just remember one time he was showing me how I couldn't yo-yo. I mean, who
can
yo-yo?
I can't yo-yo. I just go mad with it and throw it on.
Yo-yo? I mean, it's not a skill that I ever just thought would be necessary. And he was like, come on, you must be able to yo-yo. It was for, I think it was for Sugar magazine. And then he put his hand over my hand to show me how to yo-yo. And I was like, oh, yeah.
It's a classic move.
Classic.
The old yo-yo
trick. The old yo-yo trick. That's how he snared me.
So were you kind of up and running quite quickly? Did you start working with kind of fair regularity straight off the bat?
Well, it didn't really work like that. I think it's a very different kettle of fish now. But then you kind of did loads of tests.
Yeah.
And I was very editorial looking, you know. I had the gap in the teeth. I wasn't your classic. If I walked past a build, actually I had massive tits. So if I did walk past a building site, I would get whistled, but it wasn't like...
You do have quite big ones for a model, I must say.
They're very big at the moment because I'm still breastfeeding. Mm. But they're naturally quite...
You've got boobs.
Yeah. But I wasn't classic as in nowadays, if I'd started out and there'd have been Instagram then, people would have been like, I don't get it. What's so model-like about you? I was more editorial. But I did really well editorially straight away. And I was really lucky that I just worked really well from the beginning. Thank God, because in my head, I mean, I never really go into anything thinking that it might not go well. And I don't know whether it's just luck or I've just got a kind of, you know, that tunnel vision with things.
Yeah, and there's a lot to be said for that degree of kind of chutzpah, I think. If you have that kind of an unbreakable belief that it'll turn out okay, that probably carries you.
Well, I never thought that I'd be very... I was never amazing at it You know, like really tall. I was never really skinny. I wasn't like your classic model, but I did, I think I talked my way into a lot of things.
Modeling is such an ephemeral career, and obviously you're an intelligent person, you go into this job, you must surely know at this point that you, your days are numbered, that you have 5 years, 10 years, 15 years or whatever. Did you ever have a plan B? Did you think, I'll go back and be a lawyer, or did you have your sights set on something else altogether?
Well, I only ever intended to be a model for, I think, 2 or 3 years.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, and then I thought, I didn't know what I thought I'd do. I mean, I knew that I didn't want to do law.
Right.
I found it really boring. Basically, I didn't take a gap year, so I got a place at Oxford and kind of discovered boys and then didn't go to Oxford. Ended up going to Birmingham because I didn't want to move away from home.
Yeah.
So I got UCAS to change all of my things around, yeah, so that I didn't, I got the fear of moving away. And really, I think things would have been a lot different if I hadn't, you know, discovered boyfriends and had maybe kind of gone the other route. And I wasn't really into the whole uni thing. You know, if I'd gone away to uni, let's say to Oxford or wherever, you know, Bristol, I think, was on my UCAS form, then I think I would have thrown myself into the whole life and I'd have made
right.
loads of friends.
So you might not have started modelling in the first place because you'd be more into what you were doing.
I absolutely don't think I would ever have started yeah. modelling. But as it was, you know, I was commuting from home with my best friend from secondary school and we just stuck together. She was doing a different subject, but yeah, we stuck together and didn't really make any other friends. And so that was something that I knew that I wasn't going to go back to. But when I first started modelling, I also started creative writing at the same time because okay. I'd always wanted to be a writer. So I did that. And then modelling kind of dragged on and on and on just because it was going really well.
Yeah.
And I was making, you know, when the advertising jobs started coming in, they were huge then. I don't think that they're the same now, but the kind of money that you can make by doing a big hair commercial, for example, I mean, you could do one and just
live off it for a year.
Years.
Yeah.
You know, there were girls, I knew a girl that did a Herb Lessons campaign. I think 5 years later, her royalties were still like
yeah.
a house, you know,
yeah.
that kind of thing. It was insane. And so it seemed stupid to give it up when I could only do that for a finite amount of time
yeah.
and I could always go and do something else. But
yeah.
I really got the writing bug. And then I did an open university degree while I was doing that as well. And then I kind of started thinking, what am I going to do when this phases out? But before I'd really had a chance to think about it, it did start to phase out. So it almost forced my hand,
really. In what regard?
I got married and the recession hit pretty much at the same time. And as a model, you've really got to move around. So you've got to do different markets. You get stale. And I'd done everything here. I mean, at one point, if I went down the high street, I might be in 3 or 4 different shops. If you went through the magazine rack, I'd be in, you know, it wouldn't be like, am I in a magazine? It'd be how many magazines am I in this month? You know,
there's nowhere else to go.
There was nowhere else to go, and the agents were like, look, you know, you need to either go to Paris or to New York, and not like your idea of going to Paris. Mine was like 2 days, and I'd be like, I want to come home. I don't like being away from home. So, you know, I needed to go and do a different market, and I wasn't prepared to do that. So I thought, let's get the writing kick-started, and wanted to work at a magazine, but couldn't really get my foot in the door anywhere. I think there was a bit of the fact that I'd worked with a lot.
Yeah.
I thought it would open a lot of contacts for me, actually, because
yeah.
I'd worked with people, but nobody really wanted to go there. And at the same time, I did some journalism postgraduate stuff. And then I was about to start my MA in creative writing. And I thought, I really need to actually do some writing to get myself back
yeah.
into the habit daily. And that's when I started doing a model recommends. So
where were we at this point in the game in terms of the kind of blogging revolution? How early an adopter were you, or were there some prominent bloggers up and running doing stuff?
I didn't really know the term blogger when I started it. So I had this idea to do a model recommends, and I didn't know whether it was going to be some kind of magazine, or but that just seemed too complicated with too many overheads, or, you know, I didn't really know what form that it was going to take, or I wanted to write a book or just something to share anecdotes and beauty tips and all that kind of thing that just happened on a daily basis that people seemed to be really interested about, but there was no way to share it.
So had you, just to rewind slightly to get a sense of context, when you'd been modelling, had you been absorbing makeup artist tips and you'd been collecting products or getting tips from people on the crew?
I was driving them mad. Right. I mean, somebody would be doing my makeup and they'd be like, can you just shut up for 10 seconds while we do your lips? Because I'd be poking around, oh, why do you do that? Oh, what's better about that one? You know, splodging things all over my hands. Generally drive them mad. And also, because a lot of the job just did my brains in, I was always writing, jotting down anecdotes, saving them up in my head, making them worse than they were. You know, I had loads of stories.
Yeah.
And I wanted to, I thought, let's get these down. And then I think that it was my husband came home and said, oh, there's this thing called blogs and you can kind of set them up with Google and you can just write stuff on them. And I was like, oh, I'll give that a shot. And then about a month after I did that, I thought, no, I'm going to do this properly. I think this is, you know, a good thing.
Can you remember what your first post was?
It must still be on there.
Yeah.
I think it might have been something. It's probably something. This is how much things have changed. It's probably something about like how to get your face tanned in the sun. You know, it's probably something really bad and inappropriate. Or it might be about the Dermalogica multi-active vitamin mask.
Okay.
Which I've used for...
Is that your longest standing love affair product-wise?
I think that it is. And it's really funny because I don't think I've tried hardly any other Dermalogica products.
Yeah.
I think I've tried about three.
Funny how you can just fall in love with something in isolation like
that. Yeah,
So at which stage did you start thinking, shit, this seems to be a big thing. This seems to be taking off. Not just your blog, but the whole of the digital sphere. At which point did you feel like, actually, I'm onto something here?
Quite soon after I did it, I got a lot of interest from brands. And obviously, I could see my reader numbers going up and up, and that was the main thing. But when brands started contacting me and saying, oh, we love your blog, I was like, oh, wow, actually quite a few people are reading this. This is amazing. But I'd, like I said before, I'm quite tunnel visioned. And before I do something, I always think I'm gonna make this good, you know?
You have to kind of see the end goal.
Yeah, otherwise I'm quite impatient, so I can't be asked to do something. I don't know whether that's a right attitude or wrong attitude, but I'm just, that's just the way I am. Mm. And so I'd really thought it out. I'd thought out the whole of A Model Recommends as a branding thing. I'd made sure that I could get all of the names on different platforms, and I kind of could see where I wanted to go with it. So yeah, I knew that people were reading it, but in that kind of maybe semi-arrogant way, I don't know whether it is or not, of me always doing something only if I know that I can make a good bash at it.
Yeah.
I would have been disappointed if it hadn't.
That's not arrogance, that's kind of vision and graft, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a nice way of putting it.
But you can imagine it being a success and making it worth your time and money and all of that, then there's no point doing anything, is there?
No. And it came to the point as well where, I mean, if you're a model, you have to do maybe 2 weeks of, it depends how good you are, but you could do 2 weeks of castings and never get a job. I mean, my hit rate was brilliant at first, but then as people know you and you get older, let's face it, I mean, like after 25 or whatever, there are new girls coming in, and I was doing jobs at 30 with girls who were 15. And we would both be stood there in lingerie, and I just start, or maybe not 30, but you know, definitely like 27, 28. And I was thinking, oh, come on, this
no
is ridiculous.
One wants that. Yeah.
So, you know, I did have to make a call between the two. And although I still do the odd job, I mean, mostly it's as A Model Recommends not as Ruth Criddy.
Right.
Very quickly, I had to phase one out to be able to do the other. And it just, you know, I had to focus on my recommends.
Yeah, if I see a photograph of you now, and obviously that does happen with relative frequency, I think of you in the capacity of your new job rather than in the capacity of a kind of nameless model.
Yeah.
You would generally be employed for that reason.
Well, and that's the other thing. I can't do a nameless job.
Yes.
Because it
you're
never
bringing
be.
Stuff to it.
Yeah.
So the whole sort of blogging thing was kind of exploding, right? And social media was taking off in such a big way. How did you kind of rejig your aspirations in terms of suddenly, I guess, anything was possible? Were you thinking, I'd like my own beauty brand, or I'd like my own clothing brand? Or at which point did you start to think in kind of slightly bigger terms?
I think that I wanted the website to maintain, I wanted it to be really good quality. So I wanted it almost to be, you know, the quality of an online magazine or something like that. And I've got better at that actually since having a baby and my time's more precious. I have to really focus on what I do. I don't write any old shit just to get something out there. You know, I'm a bit more discerning, I think. And I'm not so much like, got to get a post out every day. It's more, you know, what have I got to say?
Yeah.
And have I got something to say about this? I hadn't really had time. It just went so crazy and it was all consuming. And I created this monster and all of a sudden I was working like 70 hours a week, standard every single week, with a husband going, like, am I actually going to see you? You're going to come out of this room? Or are you going to... And I was like midnight, no, you go to bed, you know. So I was so caught up in that. I hadn't really thought where I'd go with it. It was like a drug, you know. I just wanted to keep going with it. And I love writing. And I actually love making the content as well. And I do everything from taking every single still life photo to coding my website to make it look the way it looks. It is like some weird obsession.
I think it's now much less about the medium, whether it's newspaper, magazine, blog, vlog, whatever. It's much more about the voice, about that person's individual voice. In other words, do people trust that voice? Are people engaged by that voice? I don't think that people really give a damn now whether you're a blogger, a journalist, a vlogger. It's do we like you? Do we trust you?
Yeah.
Have you found that that's changed over the years? That it's gone in that direction?
Yeah, because you're putting yourself out there on so many different platforms. So somebody that follows you on Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and follows your writing, they know, and they maybe, you know, they get my email every morning at breakfast. You're almost a part of someone's life. Yeah. And I have people that I follow that they're, you know, if I'm reading you on Twitter before I go to bed, I'm kind of like, oh, what's Sally up to? And then maybe I'll go on Facebook and... Not that I stalk you, but I do.
I'm very different on Facebook because I know everyone.
So true. And I think there's lots of journalists now who are now, I don't know, what would you say? It's not a personality, but maybe it is a personality. I don't think of them as, oh, that is such and such who writes for that magazine. I think of them as a person and not a journalist. So, yeah, I mean, it's changed a lot.
I think what digital has done is it's forced people to be engaging as a person, that it's not just enough anymore to be a byline on a page or a byline as a model. You kind of have to be, and we've seen it with models too, that you have to be a personality that's engaging on social media and across lots of different platforms.
Yeah, and even, well, apparently, you know, just if you're just going to a normal model casting now, there are brands that say, don't bother turning up unless you've got over this many thousand Instagram followers. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So my friend said the other week, who'd been to a casting, was horrified, or didn't bother going to the casting, apparently, because she didn't have enough Instagram followers. So
So when it comes to products, you started doing this, and I mean, you were writing about various things, weren't you? You weren't just writing about beauty, you were writing about clothes and interiors.
Yeah.
And a whole lifestyle.
Whatever story pops into my head.
Whatever you're into that week. So presumably at this point, products start coming in because the blog is up and running and doing really, really well. Were you just like kid in a candy store? Was it a kind of dream come true for you?
Yeah, a little bit. But you know what? Even from the first thing that arrived, I felt this immense pressure that like, oh my God, they're going to expect me now to write about that. And quite often, I'll actually lose, because there's so much stuff, I'll lose the sample of something in the quagmire of my office, and I will actually have to go out and buy the thing that I'm writing about to be able to take a bloody picture of it, because it's so embarrassing to have to say, oh, you know that lovely career, I just want to feature it, but could you send me another one? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not going to happen. So quite often I do that anyway, which is a really nice feeling. I was speaking to someone else about this, thinking of just kind of setting aside a budget every month and just buying the things that I needed to buy to write about, and because dealing with samples is a massive pressure, and especially ones that you must know this, that you haven't asked for, which is 95% of it, I find very difficult. I'm like,
I don't see. That's really interesting. I don't find it at all difficult. The reason I don't find it difficult is that it is not possible to write beauty, balanced beauty coverage.
No.
About things that you, the only things that you pay for. Mm. And the reason it's not possible is because anybody using their own money will just buy things that appeal to them on a gut level.
Yeah.
You'll never find anything by accident. You'll never chance across something that seems like a nightmare on the outside, but actually turns out to be a lovely product. It's like getting a film reviewer to only to buy his own cinema tickets or her own cinema tickets. Mm. She's only ever going to go and see a film she wants to see. So already, I think your coverage is compromised. Mm. Also, you're never, if you're paying for things, you're going to stick within a certain price bracket because you don't want to risk buying loads of cheap stuff or you don't want to risk buying something that's 300 quid. When you get all samples together for free, it levels the playing field and you just look
True.
At the product.
Yeah, if I'm doing five different types of exfoliating acid, for example, there is no way that as a normal consumer, I would have gone out and bought five different ones just on the off chance that I might like
you're
one.
You're only ever going to buy things that are suitable for your skin is the other thing.
Yeah, yeah. But I felt the pressure very early on that I should be thinking to myself, would I have spent the money on
this? I think you're absolutely right about that. I did that too.
And yeah, so I kind of had to have this set of rules. And I think in week two, that kicked in. I think I'd been sent about three things and I was like, oh, you know, am I supposed to now write about this? And that's just weird. So you have to work out this whole little set of rules that you have for yourself, which becomes a lot easier. And now I just, you know, if it's brilliant, I write about it. If it's shit, it goes in the charity pile.
Exactly.
So, you know, I'm really fast at doing it.
Yeah.
And some things you can just tell straight away aren't.
Well, makeup is easy. Perfume's easy because it's an instant.
Skincare's the difficult one.
Skincare, you've only got one face, so you have to kind of bide your time and give things a chance. But colour and
cleansers.
Perfume. Cleansers are easy. Acid toners are quite easy.
Yeah.
But yeah, kind of anti-aging stuff, serums and things are a bit more of a long haul, aren't they?
Yeah, and when I look in my categories on my website for things like serums, I'm like, I've done about four, you know.
Because you want to get, but that, yeah. I think that's more honest in a way.
Mm.
Like if you look at the way I write, you'll see that I would typically do two colour, one skincare, hair or nails in a month cycle because I can't do more than one skincare a month.
Yeah.
And you would never see the same type of skincare follow month on month because I've only got one face. Yeah, it's kind of the only way you can do it, honestly.
Although sometimes I do a half-half.
Yeah.
I like a half-half.
Do you?
Yeah, I do like a half-half. Mm. I like being able to wake up in the morning and go, oh, this side's a bit greasy. You know, this side feels really dry and tight. The other doesn't, and I like it, and I jot down all my little notes in my notebook.
Yeah, it's quite satisfying that.
Yeah.
So you have a room full of product. Presumably some of it is interesting to you, some of it isn't, some of it's wrong for you, and I guess you pass it on to people who it's right for, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Things in here, have they graduated? Have they had the seal of approval and been brought in here?
Yeah, some of the stuff is stuff that I'm trying.
It's still in progress.
A lot of the stuff will just be stuff that I've bought along the way is just because it's stuff that I use. It's completely nothing to do with work.
Yeah.
So
what would be an example of something you bought that you just loved?
I'm on about number six of this.
Oh, what's that then?
Just a serum. Tony and Guy serum.
Tony and Guy Casual Radiating Tropical Elixir.
Mm.
So it's a UV filter.
This nice.
As a classic.
Label coming off. Body Shop.
It's an absolute classic.
Saying rest of the stuff is stuff that I'm trying up there actually. And then things like the Philip Kingsley, I buy one of those about once every 6 months.
Okay, so this is a beloved
thing.
Product for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, which I did find through, first of all, being sent a sample.
Mm-hmm.
But then.
It's great that, jumping.
Yeah, I just kind of replenish it. The Elemis one's probably like second one of those. What else? Everything else is probably stuff that I'm either trying.
So you've got the Heathcote and Ivory Cafe Fusset.
I love
it. I
know. It's so summery.
I know. I very lazily put it in everything I did for Christmas because I loved it so much. Everything it I wrote is about Christmas presents, in it went because I loved it.
It's good packaging.
So kids' toys, you've got a Pixie Glow Mud Cleanser.
Yeah. That's nice. A little bit of glycolic in that.
Good bit of ameliorate. Always nice.
The Votri cleansing oil, which I'm trying, and I love, but it's pricey.
I like it. I like it. I've been using it. Is cleanser your thing?
I like cleanser because in terms of writing about it, as you say, you just know from the first use, really, because you're washing it off. It's not
does
like
your
it's
skin feel nice? Is the towel clean when you dry your face? If those
to
two things
sting
are
sting the that. Shit out of your eyes, yeah. Because I can't stand that when it's one of those all over creams and then it stings your eyes. It's like, no. That's quite easy to do. And sometimes, you know, when time is a bit of a premium, I can't be, you know, comparing two serums is like a 6-month job.
Yeah.
Whereas cleansers.
Yeah, easy.
You know, I can try it out the night before and write about it maybe a couple of days. I normally give it like 3 or 4 goes, to be honest.
Yeah.
I never try something once and then write
about
it. Unless it's a lipstick
with
a colour thing.
I kind of like to try cleanser with a really heavy face full of makeup on a normal day in the morning.
Yeah.
So you kind of get a bit of a 360 degree view.
Yeah.
So what's this? Clinique Smart Eye.
I've just started trying that one. And this, I've been putting on underneath other eye creams. I don't know whether you're even supposed to do that, but because it looked like the Smart Serum, I thought it was an eye serum. But that should teach me to read stuff, which I don't a lot of the time.
A bit of micellar water.
Smell this baby.
Oh, I love that. I love Child's Farm. It's such a
Have you smelled this one, though? It smells like Body Shop Satsuma.
Yes, I have, but it is lovely. I gave the whole range to some friends of ours with a little boy who has eczema, and they just think it's made the world of difference. So nice.
I've been using it on myself. And then I feel really bad, because I'm like, God, how many body things have I got? And then I'm stealing it from my child.
Oh, well, I've just stolen it from your child, so there we go. So what do we have behind here? Fragrance and boy stuff.
That's some boy stuff. He's allowed his stuff there.
So, but there are some girls' fragrances on the top. What kind of scent are you drawn to?
I'm really into oudy rose kind of scents. Always have been. But I quite like a bit of fig as well.
Yeah, I
think
like
there's
a
couple
of
fig things up there. And I love the Tom Ford Santal blush, which smells a bit like cat piss sometimes. But then... on some people, it's really weird because I smelt a woman in it on the tube and I was like, are you wearing Santal blush? And it smelled a bit weird.
It smells
great on me.
Yeah.
Smells absolutely brilliant.
It's weird how fragrances can be so different from one person to the next.
Yeah. What's behind there? Lancôme L'Olivier Belle, which when I first smelled it, I was like, oh my God, that's so the opposite of any perfume I'd ever wear.
Very feminine and girly.
And it's so full on.
Yeah.
But literally the first day I wore that, about 10 different people came up to me and said, what are you wearing?
Isn't it weird?
Yeah.
I had this, I went to a fragrance launch recently. It was for Baccarat 950 Rouge. And I smelled it at the launch and thought, now that's an exquisite perfume, but it's so not me. It's so not me. But I had it on me. And that whole day, everyone I met and gave a hug to said, oh my God, that's amazing, that perfume. And it totally influenced it. And now I love it. I wear it all the time. But sometimes you can
Well, I suppose
really
it's like if you wore a dress and everyone and you thought, oh, I'm not sure I look very good in this, but everybody said you look amazing.
You'd kind of
wear
have
it
to
again.
Believe it in the end.
Yeah, yeah.
So what do we have here? So we have some number 5.
It has got number 5 in it. But it's more of a display thing.
Well, it's
because,
just an icon, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's a beautiful
I love it.
Thing. And Majestic Rose. So this would very much be along the lines you're talking about,
yeah.
Wouldn't it?
A lot of my stuff is in my office. Mm-hmm. Oh, look, he started his strimmer. Keith and his strimmer next door.
Come on, Keith, sort it out.
God, Keith.
Can I sniff black and white? I love the smell.
Do you know what? He uses it and then he leaves the empty pots, right? So I've just chucked, I think there's like 3 empty pots in the bin. So why are you collecting the empty pots? There's 2 more pots in his... Sorry, having a good old man moan.
I do love the smell.
Considering it's really one of his only beauty products, I suppose I can't complain.
I do love that smell. There's a whole chapter on that in my new book. That'll confuse people.
When I was just about to give birth... we were living in holiday lets because the house was being renovated. And the black and white is his only thing that he has to have.
Right.
And we're moving to these holiday lets. And I said, I'm just going to whittle down our things from the bathroom, dear. And send, you know, a lot of the stuff back. We had a storage locker on the front garden here. And so we'd gradually just put stuff back in it because we knew we were going to move back in and we couldn't cart it all around with us and we were having a baby. And I packed his black and white. It was
shit
trouble.
Hit the fan.
Oh my God. I mean, it was like I'd chopped one of his legs off. So I bought him the Dax from the shop and got an eyebrow when I got back in the car. So it was like, that's not what I use.
So you're up there, then he pretty much has this space to himself.
This is new, this shelf arrangement. I haven't really worked out. I'm slightly disappointed with the shelf spacing, I have to be honest. I think that they could be...
You could probably get another one in there, couldn't you, if they were shorter?
Well, the thing is, though, he said, are you absolutely sure that's the spacing you want? And I went, yeah. Are you absolutely sure? Because I have to drill into tile, which apparently is a really big thing.
Yes, it
drilling
is.
Into tile. It requires special drill bits. Lots of measuring going on.
Yeah.
And I wasn't really listening and I didn't really look when he pointed out where he wanted them.
So you screwed up, basically, is what you're saying.
I screwed up. And now I'm wondering, you know, will there be a divorce if I ask him if we can add a couple in, but also move the spacing?
Yeah. So this is your makeup bag. Can we have a look?
Yeah.
In there? So first of all, I should say, I have this bag and Chanel are the best in the world at sending their products out in nice things.
Yes.
They're so good at it.
They're good for photographs.
Well, they're good for photos. All of us keep the bags that they come in. So what's in here?
Dun, 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 dun. I've had to be really strict with myself because I'm not allowed product in the house anymore now that I've got my office at the end of the garden.
Okay.
However, as you've seen, it's completely all over the house.
Yeah.
But I like to pretend for appearances sake that it's not. So, you know, when he says the makeup's all over the place, it's not. It's all in one bag.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
And I'm doing quite well at this.
So this is quite pared down.
Oh God, this is so pared down.
Really pared down.
Really, you know. There should be like 8 foundations in here.
I'd take that much on
powder.
The train with me, frankly.
Mm. So, favourite foundation, Chanel Perfection Lumiere Velvet.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't work for me at
really?
All.
Really?
No.
Too dry?
It's too dry, but girlfriends of mine absolutely love it. So it's just a personal thing. Mm. It does not work for me, but they look great in it.
It just goes on so smoothly on my skin. But since my skin's been drier since having a baby, I do have to moisturise very well under that.
Yeah, no, it's too dry for me.
But do you know what I like the most about it is just for travelling.
Oh, it's brilliant.
It weighs nothing.
Brilliant.
And it's square.
Yeah, it's square, it's squeezy, it's smash-proof. Yeah,
brilliant. New L'Oreal... I can't even think of the name of what these are called. Nail polish. Oh, my God.
Cafe du Nuit. Yeah. L'Oreal do very good brushes, I think. They're nice and wide.
This new one, it's all come off now, but I did my nails, I think, in 35 seconds for both hands.
I just went, really, really like a wide brush. Yeah, good.
Lasts well.
Are you one for treatments or have you not got time? I've never got time.
No, never got time. I used to love it. An Amorovixa facial, you know, where they do the face pummeling. Oh my God, amazing.
Yeah, a good battery.
Yeah, it was like somebody slapping you in the face repeatedly.
I want that though. I want to feel stuff going on. I don't like the strokey, floaty thing.
Do you know what I hate most? Wafting and then going, I'm going to leave you for 20 minutes.
Don't. Take minutes. Some blackheads out.
And when they whisper and it's all spitty whisper in your ear. Yeah. I had
a facial a couple of years ago with a very, very famous facialist who has a really long waiting list and costs hundreds of pounds, and I was invited to have a facial with her, and the facial was about an hour long, and I swear 45 minutes was this business over my face. It pissed me off so much. Like, it really drove me mad. I thought, well, I could be having a glass of wine somewhere now instead of lying here listening to panpipes. Like, I don't need to.
And also, you know when there's loads of, like, taking the pads on and off the eyes?
Yeah.
About 50 times. And you're thinking, just...
Do you know what the worst is when you have a really lovely, expensive facial and you come out and there's mascara under your eyes.
Yeah.
I'm like, you can definitely do a proper cleanse.
Yeah.
In...
Just do a little wipe.
Yeah, really straightforward. But... It makes you really appreciate a good facial when someone just hammers the living daylights out of your face. I want to feel.
And I did look like I'd had a facelift.
Yeah. What else do we have in here?
Brush.
So this is a Bold Metals.
Lovely. Needs
nice
a bit of a wash.
On them.
Max Factor blusher, but I use this as like my sculpting bronze nude mauve. I'm on my, ooh, I never finish product, and I'm on my,
you've hit the
second
pan.
I hit the pan on one, and that's my second one, and I'm quite a way through.
No, I have never used this product.
What?
I have never used this product.
Try it.
Mm. It's, oh, just so really, it's like nice a cream neutral powder.
I mean, seriously.
Dude doesn't like makeup.
Bronzer with loads of hair stuck to it. Nice, nice shade.
Nice. So are you a bit of a bronzing girl?
Do you know what? I've changed it a bit recently because I've started doing a bit of blush to make myself look a bit fresher. I did a little bit of an experiment looking at my recent Instagram photos and my ones from 5 years ago. I was like, bloody hell, my face has really changed. And I don't know what it probably is from being pregnant and then having a baby. But I started to look at the ways, basically I was really intently looking at my face and trying to see what changed. And it was mainly lips were slightly thinner, mm, and cheeks were slightly less full. Mm-hmm. So they've gone that way a little bit. Mm-hmm. So I've started...
How old are you?
35. Mm-hmm. So I've started wearing a bit of blush here.
Bit of a perk up.
Rather than doing like a heavy sculpt. I like a heavy sculpt, but I do think it makes me look a bit older.
Right.
And then I've been trying to remember to wear a bit of lip stuff because I always just go nude on the lips and, mm-hmm, don't put anything on. And actually, it can look quite flat when the rest, mm-hmm, of you's done. So...
Oh, you can't beat a little round pot.
I quite like this on lips as well, although, yeah, it is a bit chalky.
It's a
bit
classic
chalky
product, that.
Yeah. Cream blush, number one. Somebody said in my comments that they're discontinuing that.
I don't think so.
I wouldn't have thought so.
I don't think so, because we've just spoken to them about my book, this product's in my new book, and I think they would have said to us, because the book's not coming out till the end of the year.
Oh, rewind. New book.
Book in September.
Excellent.
Yes, book in September.
Oh, that's my Christmas present sorted, mm-hmm, then.
I'm sure you'll get one.
I can't remember how many I bought last time. Oh. And literally everybody got Sally Hughes' book for Christmas. Diego Della Palma concealer.
I like this brand.
Yeah, I really
They've
like it.
They've got a couple of really, really good. The brow stuff is good. See, that's a good colour as well.
Yeah.
No pink in it.
I would like this with a sponge applicator.
Yeah.
I'm not so keen on the tubes. They're great for makeup artists, I think. But yeah. I quite like just to be able to dunk and...
Yeah, you like a kind of a built-in.
The retoucher.
Oh, Charlotte Tilbury retouch.
I'm a bit heavy on the concealer.
Number are you two? Yeah.
Yeah, number two. A Morovixa concealer.
Yeah, now I love that brand. Oops.
Have you tried this? I quite like it because it's really dry.
Yeah.
So,
but if it's a stick, I want it to be really dry and unmovable because you want to be able to cover a big zit, don't you?
Yeah, look at that.
Yeah.
Nice. Really like it.
Lots of pigment.
I have to, if I'm using it under the eyes, I have to prep really well and, you know, use a nice eye cream. Otherwise it can look a bit dry, but I like that a lot.
Yeah, that is
nice. New Bobbi Brown. What are even these called?
They are so good. I love them.
The packaging though.
The packaging is beaut, but also the product is great.
Yeah. They can't really go wrong though, can they, old Bobbi?
No, no.
There's very
That's been a very strong moment for them, that palette, I think.
Yeah. Well, I think because of the packaging as well, changing up. Yeah. It's always nice to have a bit of something different, isn't it?
New balls, please.
Really old palette from Chanel. Thies Van Dom. Because I like that. I've got a real thing for these peachy, coppery, pink colours.
Like a lab mouse, yeah, in that.
So do I, but I can't stop wearing them.
You like the lab mouse look. Interesting.
And I do the peach, and peach. Just, I just love it.
Tis
and then
a
I
lovely
look,
palette,
I look back
that.
And think, oh, that was a mistake. And then I do it again the next day just because... I can't help myself.
Do you know though, it's not that pink. It's more kind of...
No, it's peachy. It's peachy like, coppery.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is a nice palette.
Mm. I don't like anything with greens and blues in pretty much.
I like clear. Greens and blues.
They don't suit me that much. So it's always kind of more earthy tones and
I
coppery.
I think blues have to be navy if you've got blonde hair, because if they're any paler, it looks a bit sugary little girl, doesn't it?
It looks a bit Britney Spears.
Yeah,
early
a bit
years.
Little girl found
Not
in mom's
early,
makeup
early years,
bag.
Best brush
yes,
ever.
Yes, rate that brush. It's in
what
my
is
bag
it,
right
what's
now.
It called, this one? The smudge brush from Real Techniques.
It is a very good brush.
Scribble on my eyeliner, Smudge, 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 smudge.
But this
perfect
is the
smoky
thing
eye.
That nobody realises. Nobody who, like, people who don't normally wear makeup. So it's so hard, it's so hard. And I just want to say, if you get a pencil and a smudge brush, you can do anything and no one will know it was a mistake.
No.
Smudge, smudge.
Do you know,
smudge.
I saw somebody on YouTube applying eyeshadow with the sponge applicator that comes with the eyeshadow.
Okay.
And
I just throw them away.
I literally open the bin, tip the thing upside down, and the plastic thing that holds those in, all three things, straight into the bin. Yeah. Because when am I ever going to use it?
No one's going to ever use them. No, I know. I do the same
thing. I mean, you
thing.
Cannot apply makeup with that.
Well,
you could do a little bit around the lash line, I suppose. It's a bit like a Q-tip, isn't it?
You have to come kind of so far in because the handle's about that long, isn't it? And the sponge thing wipes away more product than it adds.
It does. And then sometimes the stick is poking through a bit and then it...
Oh, the pokey stick when it breaks through the sponge.
Yeah.
And just
I hate a pokey stick breakthrough.
No, the pokey stick breakthrough is end of days. Really scratchy. That's an amazing brush.
How good is this?
So that is... Okay, I should
explain. Another double-ended.
This annoying... this is very annoying. This brush was limited edition at Christmas, but it's Bobbi's full coverage brush.
I've
and
got
the
chipped
face,
nails. Don't zoom in on my nails.
The
Hold
face
on,
touch-up.
Light it.
So it's the full coverage foundation brush and the face touch-up brush at the other end. Now, this has been discontinued. It was a limited edition, but you can now buy both brushes on their own and they're permanent. And this end, I cannot live without. I use it every single
day. Yeah, it's brilliant.
Because you can put your corrector and your concealer on without blending, it just kind of disappears into it.
I didn't use a concealer brush until this, really.
Mm.
And then it's magical.
Yeah.
And you can get right up underneath the lash line. It's great.
It's really, really good. Okay, so what are you doing with this? Putting your concealer
foundation,
and your blush?
Foundation on with that. Yeah, I don't really do blush with it. I've got other...
Okay, let's see what you've got.
I haven't actually got them in this bag. They're all just scattered around the house. Brilliant eyeshadow brush.
I don't use that one.
Don't
so
you?
Much.
If I'm just doing a wash... of something.
Yeah, see, I've got a Charlotte Tilbury version of that that's basically that but a bit smaller and I love that.
Oh,
that,
the crease
see,
brush.
Yeah, that feels a bit too big for me.
Oh, but, I like
but
Bish Bash Brush.
Nice big eyes.
Do you think?
Yeah.
There's not much. Apparently, I've not got much space between the brow and the lash line.
That was nice, whoever pointed that out to you. Bless them.
I swear.
That's modelling for you.
I've had every single thing pointed out about my face. I think that's why things just can't touch me.
Do people's comments hurt you?
When they go, ew, your teeth. That's all the time.
Nice.
Or, how are you a model? I actually really love it. Because I just think, what a ridiculous comment.
Isn't it weird? You wonder what's going on with people's own shit that they have to point out to you that you're not pretty enough for their liking. It's
You kind of just have to laugh at them, really, don't you?
I guess.
A lot of the time I do take the stuff on board and I think that's a bit of my problem because I do like to give people's comments due consideration.
Yeah.
Especially if they're talking about product or, you know, if it's like a serious question. You know, I like to be able to, I don't like to brush things under the carpet and go, you know what, you're not worth my time answering that. But if it's just shit, I'm like, oh no, delete.
Oh, I'm
delete,
always
delete.
Really into the comments I like the most. I like it when people tell me about a product I haven't tried before. I love those comments.
Mm-hmm.
And also just like a legitimate question that's interesting or a legitimate opinion that's interesting, all of that's fine. But if somebody's just saying, oh my God, you look like a dog or whatever, I do just think, well,
oh yeah, no,
you're
pointless.
Not worth a minute of my time.
No. Some extra brushes.
These are Topshop brushes, aren't they?
I think those are Zoeva.
Oh, these are Zoeva, but they have got the same colour as Topshop.
Yeah.
They are good brushes, though.
Yeah, I think mainly I've got those in there because they're pink and I can find them.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're nice. They're good little... That's like my little eye staples, although that is my most used.
Yeah.
The Real Techniques smudge one.
Yeah, it's really good.
What's this? Oh, nice little cream shadow...
So this looks like a Dolce one, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, creamy eye colour in gold
just
dust.
Nice for just, that's a recent discovery, just as a little dusting.
Okay, here is my problem with pots. Nails.
Yeah. Sometimes I'll use a little brush.
Yeah, I have to do brush because that happens.
Have you done a big dent out of it now?
Yeah, I've ruined your product. I hope that's fine.
I don't have that problem because as soon as my nails get even remotely long, I tear them off. Which is a really bad habit, but I've always done that. Which is why half my nail varnish has come off as well. What else do we have in here? Lip Parfait from Laura Mercier.
So you're not much of a lip person, but you do like a bit of a nudie thing.
Yeah. Or if it's not that, then I go for a really bright hot red.
Yeah.
But you know what? Because A, I'm quite clumsy, and B, I'm really low maintenance.
This is Reeve Gauche, by the way, if anyone's asking.
Yeah, lovely, that one. I'll put a bit on. I very often don't wear a bright lip just because I know that I'm the type of person that will get home at the end of the day and I'll have gone like this on the train and it'll be up here and the whole day it'll have been like that. So I just think I try to minimise my mishaps throughout the day, and that is one of the things.
Do you do your makeup on the train on the way into London?
Yeah, I do sometimes. I'm not that fussed about doing makeup in front of people. I probably wouldn't pluck my eyebrows
or something
like that.
You can't do anything that sheds things, I think, because that's just rude. So you can't brush your hair
or file your nails. That would be wrong.
Or clip.
Or even paint them, because I think then you fumigate people.
Yeah.
And also, I wouldn't spray perfume.
No, neither
would I. My mum, sorry about this, mum, but we were in a restaurant the other week and she liberally spritzed herself. We're having afternoon tea. No. There were only two other people in there, but I was going to say, mum, no.
I think you can't do anything that imposes on anybody else. You have to maintain your own little space, and that goes for fumes, hair, dust, powder. Mm-hmm. You have to be contained.
Eating as well.
Yeah.
People that crack out an egg sandwich. What are you doing?
It's rude. When you get on, we call
Wine?
It the last
Fine.
The last train home to Brighton is called the Vomit Comet. Oh. There's just so many pissed idiots. But the number of kind of Burger King, that smell of Burger King and McDonald's that fills the train with kind of shouting, puking men.
Yeah.
It's a bad thing.
I don't like it.
I wouldn't eat a sandwich on the tube, would you?
Do you know what? I have done quite a lot, because if I was doing castings, you would just, the only time that you would stop would be on the tube between places. Mm. And so I'd just walk something down.
I don't like to be facing somebody.
No, so here's the thing. I'd have to stand in one of those corner bits and eat it.
Yeah.
I couldn't sit and eat
like
it.
Like a naughty child.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's in here? Skincare.
Let's have a look, shall we? Oh, that was...
We can just peer in there.
We can peer. Lots of masks. Zellin's Transformer.
I love Zellin's.
What's this? Oh, the multivitamin.
Your beloved.
Been using
that. Why do you love this so much, please?
I first loved it because it turns your face orange. And I just found it really amusing. And then it just did really... So I first started using it when I was first modelling, and I was always hungover. And it was a really good hangover mask.
I can't believe you drink. It's disgusting.
I know. Do you know what? I've probably had a total of about 4 glasses of wine in a year.
Because of the baby.
Because of the baby. And I feel amazing. I don't want to be preachy about it, but it's really good.
Are you
good.
About to become a teetotal then?
No.
No.
I absolutely bloody love a glass of wine, a glass of red.
Okay, so Alginist, lovely brand. So this is another cleanser. This, I can feel, has been well loved.
Yeah, I love that. This is a new tube of the Dermalogica.
But you've been using it.
Look at that.
For 100 years, yes?
Yep.
Okay.
That's another cleanser, Ren.
I like that cleanser.
That's really nice.
Yeah.
Boob tube. That's not a mask.
Do we really believe in this? Or is this a sort of triumph of optimism over reality?
I don't even know what it's supposed
to
do.
I'm not casting aspersions on Mia. I'm casting aspersions on
Do you know why I use that? Because they've got this duo of things called Shrink to Fit Serum. And then there's this it's not an anti-cellulite cream. It's like a shrink cream.
I know the thing
cream.
You mean. It comes as a double act, doesn't it?
Yeah, but I really bloody love it.
Do you?
Yeah. I find that I get a really even kind of... It does make everything just feel a bit... It's probably not... I mean, it can't be doing anything in terms of slimming you.
No.
But it makes me feel a bit more presentable in that area. And I quite like zoning when it comes to my body stuff. So if I do a bit of body brushing here, which I haven't done in about a year, but I'm going to get back into, I'll use a separate product for my dry shins, and I will on my thighs and my stomach, and then I'll use a different thing on my boobs, probably a different thing And it's not like a, ooh, I've got this whole regime. I just like using loads of different stuff.
Yeah, you just like mucking about with it and working out what.
So, you know, by the time I've finished, everything will be everywhere and all the lids will be off. And
I love that.
Love the deep comfort.
Yeah, I love that.
That's gorgeous. And I love their sparkle skin.
Yeah, I like
sparkle. It's one of the only body exfoliators, I think, that actually works and isn't crap and goes all down the drain. Lipikar, La Roche-Posay. Dry shins.
Great brand. I love that product.
I had it in the tube. I've just finished the tube. So this is the new
packaging. So this is a repurchase.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great
It probably won't. I haven't even activated the pump yet.
No, I've just activated it for you.
I better start using that then.
Taking its virginity.
Used this when I was pregnant because I wanted an exfoliating mask, but everything was too strong. Mm-hmm. And I love pie for when my skin is sensitive.
Yeah, lovely. The cleanser's lovely.
It's not I've used for years, and on modelling jobs, my eyes get really sore under here if I take makeup on and off. Uh-huh. And when you're doing a beauty job...
Yeah, you could have five different faces on.
And so many makeup artists used to use wipes, Johnson's baby wipes on my eyes, and they just used to kill. So I started taking my own stuff. And I used to put on, say we were breaking for lunch, I'd just put a massive thick layer of the EKMI cream on. Mm-hmm. Ready for the next
I don't think I've tried that.
Oh, it's lovely. It's really just really gentle. And
I do love this brand though. I love their day cream and their
Tilbury Goddess mask.
Yeah,
kind of like a primer almost. I mean, I know you wipe it off, but rinse it off. It just leaves my skin really like I've got a primer on, smooth and nice. So that's in there. Sanitary towels, don't want to see those. Tangle teaser. Looks like one that Batman would have, mm-hmm. So I like that one. Some baby socks.
Models, I always think models' hair takes such a hammering, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I know that you mainly do your kind of second career now, but when doing a flurry of modelling, your hair's just like constantly in appliances and...
Yeah, once somebody cornrowed my hair and then clamped straighteners down each cornrow, right? So like that. Heated the crimps into my hair.
Right.
Undid them.
Right.
Backcombed it. This was in Paris. Probably would have guessed that. Backcombed it, then got a balloon and rubbed the balloon. Like, this is some people's idea
then
of a complete
set
nightmare.
Set it alight.
Set it alight, got a fire extinguisher, kicked me to the ground, rolled me in a rug, beat me, and then rubbed a balloon so that it was completely frizzy, like a halo.
That sounds nice.
That was difficult to get
out. So what do you do to look after it between, I suppose it's less of an issue at the moment, but...
Yeah, I just try not to use heated appliances on it very much. I only wash it probably once every 2 or 3 days.
Yeah.
I try and do 3. Dry shampoo in between. I've got very kind of lank roots.
Same.
And then I get dry on the ends. So,
when you came to do your collab project initially, was it because you had this problem that you wanted to fix with your hair?
I always said that I would only do a product if it was something that was a problem for me that would be solved.
Yeah.
And that it was something completely new that nobody had really done properly yet. And so when they said, we think we've got this amazing formula, it's invisible, but it's as absorbent as a normal dry shampoo, I was really interested because dry shampoo was one of the first products that I discovered backstage as a model that mainstream people...
Totally.
Didn't know anything about. I mean, it's
way
only
back
recently.
When you used to see dry shampoo on shoots, but then the only time you saw it in the shops was in the tiny little travel section in Boots, because it literally was dry shampoo. It was only session stylists that used it to make hair look good. Well, other people took it on camping holidays.
They would use it just to kind of almost give the hair a lived-in feel, or to lift the roots.
Yeah.
And so for me, I had always used dry shampoo, and before I obviously had my own, I was using Chlorane, because it was just the oat one. Just because if I separated my hair and sprayed it in the roots and then went like this, I got it kind of evened it out. Otherwise, my hair's like this and then out.
Yeah.
So for me, it was like a styling product. And when the people that I collaborated with were like, we see this as more of a styling product than something for people who don't want to wash their hair, I was like, That is bang
that's
on.
That's why we use it.
That's exactly why I use it.
Yeah.
And, you know, we just had the same ethos about it, I suppose. And it was a bloody good product. And
so how does that work? So they had, presumably, a bit of a technological breakthrough where they realised they could make this product and it would be invisible. So at which stage do you come in to something like that? So they have the product, they really, really want to turn it into something, they approach you about it, you're really into the idea, what happens then?
Well, I came in quite early, really, which was not, well, which would have been the only way for me because I'm a complete control freak. And to be honest, I think I drive everyone else completely mad because whereas a lot of the time people that know business will go, there has to be a line that you draw where you go, that's how it's going out because you can't spend any more time on this. I'll be like, no. I need, you know, and I obviously have to sign things off.
You've been in a million and one situations as a model where people haven't bothered to find out about you, where it's been a bit like, all right, Blondie, do as you're told, kind of sit there and look pretty, we'll handle this
God,
stuff.
God, always, yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure it happens constantly. It must happen to all models. It must be mega, mega frustrating. So it must make you, going into a project like that, a bit like, well, I need to be involved. This needs to feel like mine.
Oh, absolutely. And the other thing that made me want to do it was the fact that they wanted somebody who wanted to be completely involved. Yeah. So if I'd been like, oh, just put my name on it, it wouldn't have worked and they wouldn't have wanted me. So, you know.
Is it something you're keen to repeat with a different kind of thing?
I think the people behind Colab, the technology side of it and product developing are very, very clever. And if there are things that come out that, again, are, you know, new and they're doing it really well, then definitely. But, you know, I'm very against bringing out lots of things for the sake of getting more SKUs on the shelf, you know, just because you have to fill that shelf space. That's not me. And
I feel that like that's the opposite of the way the industry's going anyway. I was having a meeting with some very important beauty industry suity people this week. And we were talking about how more and more and more the trend is towards specialist brands that, you know, the brands of this world that do everything, like say Clinique or Lauder or Lancome or whatever, those are already there. There isn't any room for those brands anymore. And actually people, when it comes to new brands, are much more interested in, you're the specialist at face masks, you're the specialist at oils. You know, people like that kind of degree of specialist.
Or like Ico, specialist at mascara. Yeah.
Or Anastasia or, you know, whatever. Brands that just really nail one or two things is quite an appealing thing. Poppy King is another, you know.
Yeah.
People who are just really good at one
thing. I think
thing.
It's good to do one thing well, you know, if you can.
Like but Ameliorate, all they do is that one thing. It's great. Yeah. They do three products, is it? Maybe four now. That all do the same thing for the same condition. I think it's quite appealing, isn't it, when someone knows what they're good at?
Well, I would just like people, you know, they need a dry shampoo and they think of Colab. That's me happy, you know, that's great. Why do anything else? There are some really good things in the pipeline that I don't think I'm allowed to talk about yet. But, you know, again, it's doing the same thing, but just doing it really, really well. Mm. I would quite like to do, I think there's a little bit of a gap for kind of like mum and baby products that you could both use. Mm-hmm. Because most products you can both use, but from one way, you know, I've used loads of baby products, but sometimes I'm not sure whether I can use my products on her.
Yeah.
And so I'd quite like some stuff that you can just, you know, when you've just had the baby and you're like, oh, you know, even like body lotion on the arm, I was thinking, is that going to go through her skin when I'm breastfeeding and she's lying on my arm? So just a really small range of products that you can both use.
Just like a lovely baby oil you could then rub into your face.
That are really affordable though, not ramped up because it's baby stuff, which everything seems to be.
Yeah.
That could just be sold everywhere and you just pick it up and it's like, you can both use this. A salve for your lips, for their
How
lips.
How have you managed to carry on doing the job you do, living the life you do, with a baby? What have been the challenges? I mean, I guess you haven't, because nobody can. Nobody can do exactly the same thing and work on full throttle.
No.
But how have you adapted?
Because
she's how old?
She's 8 months.
Yeah.
Nearly 9 months. So for the first, I went back to work after about 3 weeks working from home, and then she slept a lot. So I got, I mean, I wasn't doing like a 70-hour week anymore, but I was probably managing about 30 hours.
Which is quite full on, to be honest.
Yeah, that's probably what I'm still doing now, but it's a lot more difficult because she's moving and she doesn't really go to sleep.
Gets a bit bored as well.
So I tend to... So my husband's freelance, so when he's a photographer, when he's not working, he'll have her. We really need to get some help, to be honest, because it's getting to the point where it's just ridiculous. And then I just have to try and find...
Pockets.
So from 7 when she goes to bed until about midnight, I'll work then. So that's good, yeah, 4 or 5 hours taking away dinner. And then just during the day, there's always admin stuff to do. So I'm like, hello, baby, and then typing with your hand. And, you know, it's not really manageable, but just got to do it. And it's my own fault because I haven't sorted out someone to help us. So I can't really complain.
It is so hard because on the one hand, when you're self-employed, you just have to do the work or you don't get the money, you don't get any maternity leave. But also on the other hand, we kind of do jobs where our partners are home, we're home. You know, you can snatch little handovers, I suppose, when I suppose other couples have to go to work. But swings and roundabouts.
I wouldn't change it for the world because I love being here. But yeah, so I've just been really slack on that front. And also, I've realised, quite a control freak.
It's very
hard. I've been like, I can do this all myself, this is fine. But on a lot of days, you know, say I've got, I'm with a client and I've got to film and there's a baby in the background, you know, just can't really do that anymore. Yeah. So.
Do you not miss living in London? Are you glad that you are here?
I don't miss it at all.
No.
I love being here. Now that the stream has stopped as well.
Yeah.
That's quite nice.
Yeah.
Just having the space and...
Chainsaw revs up.
Just having space and green and... Yeah. I mean, it's quite mad because some days, literally, I will be in Wellies, caked in mud, you know, picking up dog poo after the dog and, like, covered in cat hair. And 2 hours later, I'll be at some event and I'll be, like, completely glammed up.
Yeah.
And I always think, this is bizarre, but I just wouldn't have it any other way. I love it.
No, I wouldn't go back either. Should we have a look at your other bathroom?
Okay.
And just snoop at what's in there because I don't want to shortchange people. I'll tidy this up when we come back.
Will you?
Yes. So we are now going into Ruth's other bathroom, which I think we'll make a separate part. So we'll see you in part 2, which will be next Saturday.